In 2018 and 2019, millions of fans around the world finally saw the finale of Marvel's Infinity Saga. One of the main advantages of Infinity War over other Disney movies was the antagonist of the story. Unlike the cliché crybabies from most of other films, character of Josh Brolin, the mad titan Thanos, is a very charismatic and powerful opponent who knocked down all the main heroes of the story and, spoilers, achieved his goal. But sadly, the writers could not save him from one classic downside of every blockbuster villain. With all his coolness, what Thanos was doing was completely pointless. So, what's the problem? The film tells us the story of Thanos as a resident of a prosperous but overpopulated world in crisis. The Titan proposes to solve the problem radically, to kill half of the population so that the second half would thrive. He was not listened to, and the world eventually died. Thanos got convinced that he was right and decided to save not his own world, but the entire universe, by destroying half of all life. Beautiful speeches and convincing pictures are impressive. In addition, in our real world, there are also problems of overpopulation, poverty, hunger, and all that. As a result, the viewer is convinced that Thanos may be a villain, but he does have his own slightly disturbing logic that gives him more weight in the plot. The problem is that, despite being convincing, this idea is also wrong, and the Avengers, instead of starting an epic fight, should have shown him the rest of this video. So, let's start with the fact that these ideas first came to mind not to the 8-feet-tall purple alien in 2018, but to the old English philosopher in the 18th century. Let's take a wider look at history. In the year 1000 BC, the population of Earth was about 50 million people, and this figure was growing very slowly. By the 17th century, 2600 years later, population barely reached 500 million. Fewer people lived on the entire planet than now in the European Union. But over time, it became clear that the growth of population is slowly accelerating, and at that time lived one of the fathers of a theory that a few centuries later was picked up by a Marvel movie villain. At the end of the 18th, the beginning of 19th century in England, the priest, scientist, and demographer Thomas Robert Malthus was developing his philosophical line. He was observing a curious new trend: optimistic theories about the rise of mankind, progress and improvement of well-being of people around the world. He was observing and laughing. Stories about a bright and fair future for everyone to him seemed ridiculous and not connected to the real world. Malthus's vision resembled the biologist's observation of animals. Rabbits, birds, wolves, and bears live in a balance with nature. They hunt, breed, and die out, starving and often killing each other. This is a natural process. We don't get hysterical when we see a lion eating an antelope in documentaries. Here, Malthus's thoughts were logical, and the concept of struggle for existence became the core of natural selection, of Charles Darwin's theory of evolution, which appeared a bit later. The nuance here is that he also projected this concept onto humans, arguing that people also live in a balance with nature, which means that such phenomena as poverty, hunger, war, and disease are natural self-regulation mechanisms. And what is natural cannot be ugly, so there is no sense in fighting it. All these theories about fair distribution of resources and prosperity are not real. Lion catches the antelope, lion eats the antelope. Lion doesn't catch the antelope, lion is left without lunch. This concept led to the logical conclusion that since the number of animals in the world remains more or less stable, the number of people will be stable as well, and if there is growth, it will be very slow. In principle, the experience of generations confirmed this theory. By the time of Malthus's birth, only 800 million people lived on the entire Earth, and this mark took thousands of years to reach. Ancient history and traditional society clearly showed this. A rather high birth rate was compensated by an equally high mortality rate. However, this trend was changing, and already in those times it was simply impossible to ignore. Already during the lifetime of Malthus himself, population exceeded 1 billion, and in theory, this figure should have been reached centuries later. In front of his eyes, in a course of several decades, population of England had grown by a third. How so? Well, the problem is that we are nonetheless different from animals. Rabbits do not provide central heating to their burrows. Bears do not go fishing with nets. And lions, despite millions of years of evolution, did not start using guns for hunting. Winter frosts were not killing millions of people, predators were not eating entire villages, and disease began to slowly lose ground with the development of medicine. But there remained one stable factor: resources. Yes, in the winter you will dress warmer, the wolf will not eat you, and a simple sneeze will not kill you in a moment. But the good old hunger will eventually do its job. Yes, food production and trade with the neighbors were developing, but they did not keep up with the birth rate. Malthus calculated that in such conditions, the population will grow exponentially, and food production growth will be linear, much slower. What will be the result? That's right, economic crisis, starvation, unrest, war, genocide, epidemic, and voila! We get a bright post-apocalyptic future with the population returning to its natural numbers. A familiar thesis, isn't it? Humans are all bastards, they multiply like rabbits, Mother Earth will not provide, the end of the world will happen, and we will all die. This prediction became known as the Malthusian trap, or the Malthusian catastrophe. Naturally, since such an event is possible, we must try to avoid it. There were two solutions. First, natural mortality. Diseases, hunger, and war were still classified rather as natural phenomena, and not as a result of actions of the Homo sapiens. And second, since our mortality is falling, we must also reduce the birth rate. This concept almost immediately became famous, and caused a lot of both approval and disputes. Although at that time, few people imagined that the theory of the Malthusian catastrophe could lead to catastrophes that are real. The idea that resources are limited and not all will survive immediately gave rise to the question, who should survive? In the next 100 years, the search for answers to this question led to the emergence of such trends as eugenics and Nazism. In such a company, the idea of cutting the population in half with the help of an overpowered galactic glove fits quite well. As we know, eugenics did not last long. Nazism vanished, dragging tens of millions of people with it. And we were saved from the Uber glove by Robert Downey Jr. But if all these things didn't work, does it mean that the Malthusian catastrophe is ahead? So, the theory was formulated in the 19th century, when the population exceeded 1 billion. By 1930, there were already 2 billion of us. By 1974, 4 billion. The 21st century has met 6 billion, and now we are already over 7.5. Why are we still alive then? Here, opponents of Malthus's theory usually say that he was a cynical pessimist who did not believe in humanity. But on the other hand, it should be kept in mind that, despite the enormous influence, this theory is a result of observations of one person in the early 19th century. Thomas Malthus was watching the traditional agrarian society, an extremely, extremely inertial social paradigm that had not changed for hundreds of years. The volume of production of various supplies was growing very slowly. Yes, some inventions simplified the agriculture, and enterprises were increasing their output. But on the other hand, unemployment was rising, and the plants were damaging the environment. The birth rate was very high, and there was not enough food for everyone. Seeing the crowds of poor people on the streets, Malthus believed that with time, the situation would only get worse, and everything would end as he predicted. Only instead of many small problems, there would be something big and dramatic. But he underestimated two factors. First, remaining in the paradigm of the traditional era, he ignored progress. Some inventions over time developed into a full-scale industrial revolution, including in agriculture. Irrigation and tillage systems, new fertilizers, efficient breeding and other solutions increased the amount of food. During Malthus's times, all of England could barely feed its 10 million population, and now the small, clamped by the seas Netherlands feed dozens or even hundreds of millions of people in Europe and beyond. In addition, the development of world trade almost eliminated seasonal dependence. In the summer, you can eat your own, and in the winter, you can import from the regions where there is summer. And even if there is a drought, you can still buy food. A resident of Rio in the middle of July can savor Russian ice cream, and a resident of Moscow in the middle of December feast on a Brazilian pineapple. The second factor is more complicated. Malthus believed that the harbinger of a catastrophe will be the growth of population, and this growth is quite obvious. So, sooner or later, the resources on Earth will end and we will all die? The fact is that this incredible growth is also not infinite and is limited by such a thing as the demographic transition. This phenomenon has several stages. In the beginning, the death rate falls and the birth rate remains high, which leads to a sharp increase in population. In fact, Malthus witnessed an onset of this phenomenon in England and decided that now the world will fill up with angry, starving hobos. But the philosopher did not get to see how the Industrial Revolution, the development of education, urbanization, and other factors would lead to a decrease in birth rate. In the end, mortality and natality are almost aligned, stabilizing population. This can be observed in many developed countries and is often being used to frighten their inhabitants. You are few, you are getting old, soon the immigrants will overwhelm you, and you will disappear like the ancient Romans. The feature of the demographic transition is that it does not respect the state borders. Similar processes occur everywhere. Threats of shortage and famine can now be seen only in some regions of the world, from where we hear horrible stories about the hungry and poor people. But it's worth considering that about 100 years ago, such stories could come not from the slums of Sudan and Congo, but from the streets of London and Paris. Population growth reached its peak in the last century, and now the rates are slowly declining. It is assumed that the population will stabilize at levels of 11 to 12 billion by the 22nd century. And these are still the trends of the industrial society. You never know what the future holds. So, with the resources, the apocalypse is not gonna happen. Glorious times when people indiscriminately destroy everything they touch are coming to an end, though not as quickly as we would like. The Stone Age did not end because we ran out of stones. The world is abandoning coal energy, although there is still plenty of coal. Yeah, and in the 1960s, everyone was so anxious for acid rains from its emissions. Oil and gas, despite some people's fears, will not be depleted by next Friday, just their extraction will become more difficult. And yes, it just so happens that humanity went into space, and in the coming decades will finally begin to explore the solar system. Do you know what it is full of? Resources. All that remains is to move the progress and try not to ruin our beautiful planet. So the theory of the Malthusian catastrophe, no matter how impressive it may seem, is not very relevant. And Thanos, in fact, is not a mighty anti-hero with a tough but right motive. He is just a dangerous psycho that, in the end, was wiped out by his own glove. I hope I didn't spoil it to anyone. And you and I will have to abandon the dramatic scenario of the end of the world from overpopulation and hope for an asteroid, aliens, or at worst, an uprising of killing machines. Considering that with each movie the Terminator films are getting worse, I won't be surprised if one day they will actually become dangerous. And on this, today's dramatic story ends. No need to panic, let's just move the history forward, but still, don't forget to be careful. Malthusianism is not relevant, there is a lot of resources, but they, nevertheless, are not endless. Leave a comment on what you think about these controversial ideas, and be sure to subscribe to the channel. There is a lot of interesting things on the horizon.